Welcome to another video about the Creality CR-10 S5. In this video, we're going to see a few upgrades that I ended up doing because I ran into trouble trying to install a few things and then things got loose and then they started malfunctioning and they stopped working. So as you can see right now, this is a PETFANG tube blower for the dual 5150 or 5015 fans, and I added two notches on each nozzle to divert some of the air underneath the nozzle because most of the air was blowing behind the nozzle, thus not cooling the filament, just blowing a lot of air. I used these and eventually I discarded the whole project because eventually I ended up with under extrusion, and unknowing how to fix that, I decided to change the printer into the direct drive extruder. So this is the PETFANG I printed with the notches in the nozzles, and then I finished installing it right here. Then I installed the cable holder, which is another 3D printed part, and apparently you need a kit with all the parts and screws and nuts you actually need for a 3D printer. I'm building a list of all the tools you may need as a starter kit for 3D printing and adding to your toolbox. I'm removing the QR sticker here to remove the X-axis stepper motor to add the noise dampener, and that worked quite well. And now we're gonna move on. So as you can see, I had to remove the noise dampener on the y-axis because the belt was frictioning on the pulley and I couldn't find a way to fix it. Now I removed the extruder to add the noise dampener for the extruder, and I think that's when I ended up actually creating more trouble than fixing, because the extruder couldn't extrude properly again, or couldn't retract properly. I always had problems, and I think it's because of that valve right there that you can see with the Bowden tube. That pneumatic valve, which is a PC4/6 valve, it's not the greatest valve, and I think it's a cheap one and it messes up. Now I decided to re-add on the y-axis the noise dampener, and this is how I fixed the issue. I just pushed on the motor and then I kind of bent the bracket a little bit, and now the belt stopped making any noise. I'm not sure if I saw somebody online doing it or I just discovered it myself. This is a test with the noise dampeners compared without the noise dampeners. That's there, without the noise dampeners. So it's a similar distance, so I guess the microphone picks up, and these sounds are a little less annoying, like compared with the ones printing the cube now. So basically with the CR-10 S Pro, you cannot hear the motors almost at all, because they are, I think it's the motherboard that has those special stepper motor controllers that go in stealth mode, so you cannot hear the motors. The annoying part of the CR-10 S Pro is that the fans are super loud and you have to change them. Here I decided to change the Bowden tube to a Capricorn tube, assuming that will fix my under extrusion issue, but we will see in a few seconds that it did not solve anything. Actually, it added more issue, because I think the Capricorn tube is more slippery and it slipped more out of that valve than the Bowden tube, and that's here right there. You can see the under extrusion missing layers, and I had to stop the print and wasted a bunch of material. Then I retightened everything and I decided to print this vase again, because it all started with trying to print this huge vase and huge quality and great quality. And here it started well for a bit of time. It worked well for a day and a half, and then all of a sudden it started like stringing excessively and missing layers. And you'll see in a few seconds that it's going to have missing layers, and then the parts are going to break off. And I decided to like kind of break it off and stop the print right there. You see on the right hand side, there missing layers and this excessive shiny stringing. So I was back to the drawing boards. I couldn't finish my huge vase, so I decided to do a direct extruder. I looked on Thingiverse, I found a Teaching Tech direct drive mount, and I started printing it. And obviously I am printing it with a faulty printer, and the first print failed. However, I printed in PETG for the first time, and it is quite a bit of a challenge to get the bed to reach 80 degrees on this printer. And this is the broken part. It ripped it broke in half, and now I'm reprinting it. I changed the settings. I tried to tweak a little bit more the printer, and this print was successful. So now I'm trying to pluck all the supports out of the chicken here, and it was quite a bit of a process. I think I may have bled a little bit on some material kind of piercing my skin. And after I managed to clean it up, I was able to install this, but then managing the wires and cutting and like reconnecting all the wires made this into a mess of wires and cluster thing that it's like a cacophony of wires and weird looking things. You're gonna see in a few seconds right here. And to just complete the whole package, I had the anti-backlash nuts, which are disappointing because you can install them, but in my case I tightened them. I had the right spacing amount, the upper portion and the bottom portion, but still the right side, or the left side in this case of the printer, were still sagging down on its own. So I had to tighten the eccentric nuts on the gantry in order to prevent the x-axis from sagging on the left-hand side. And on the right-hand side, as you can see, I had to use an M2 screw because the M3 wouldn't fit, because the holes wouldn't align with the actual 3D printer. Here's another sound comparison after changing. Direct extruder from a remote or whatever type of extruder that other one may be, and this worked pretty well, and I was able to start printing the vase again. As you can see right here, this is the base of the upper portion of the vase, and the cluster of crazy things happening with the wires and the connections and the fans and the heat sinks. And I gave a Band-Aid and an Advil, but the head decided that Advil is not necessary and dropped it off. And eventually I was able to 3D print the rest of the vase, or the second 50% of the vase, which it was quite a bit of a challenge because the wires are not long enough. So I ended up suspending the base on little boxes and bigger boxes for the wires to reach properly. And then I had to move the filament holder, which I installed from the top of the base onto the top of the printer, for the filament to kind of vertically get sucked into the extruder. And the extruder right now, it's working like a charm, and finally it's pushing and it's skipping like the CR-10 S Pro when you have like the nozzle too close to the bed or to the 3D print and the nozzle cannot eject, eventually starts skipping. Whereas before, we could barely pull it in. So I'm happy that I was able to change this to a direct extruder, but now I have a cluster of wires that are either too short or too long, and I have to extend the wires, and I need JST connectors, and nobody can find JST connectors or mentions the pitch of the JST connectors required for the motherboard or in the CR-10 S5. And Stay tuned for another video. And this is an actual redesign for a phone holder and a mini pentapod I designed. And these are the pictures for the headaches. And this is the wasted filament. And that is the actual vase right there. And that was quite a bit of a ordeal to get finished and finalized after all these problems that I encounter with the CR-10 S5. And stay tuned for more videos with fixes, and you know, maybe I can create shortcuts for you rather than tweaking your 3D printer and running into trouble. You can just, you know, skip a few steps and just get the right parts and the right kit. I'm building a 3D kit for posting online with all the parts that you may require right off the bat when you buy a cheap CR-10 3D printer or any Chinese inexpensive 3D printer. Or even for updates and upgrades on the 3D printer, you have to attach them to the rails. You still need nuts and bolts and T-slot or V-slot nuts or whatever they're called. Stay tuned for the next video.